Good morning, and welcome to Pell City First United Methodist Church. It is so good to worship with you this morning. I pray that that this video finds you in a good place as we enter into a study of 1 Corinthians. It really is going to be an excellent study. It was written for a particular church at a particular time, and that's kind of where we are as well, as we've been journeying through this coronavirus season. And moving into the different seasons of our lives. I just pray that through our songs and through the prayers, as scriptures read and proclaimed, everything we do this morning would grow us closer to God and to one another. Could we join together in prayer? Now, most gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we do praise you and thank you for drawing us into your presence this morning. Lord, I pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us as we gather to worship, as we sit around the tables, as we sit at our in the kitchen, sitting in a den, walking around town, wherever it is that we find this worship this week. Lord, I pray that you would be present, that you would show up, that you would move in our lives as you bring forth in us something that unifies us in Christ. Lord, we give you thanks in everything and for all things. And we just pray that you would be the lead of this worship service this morning. We pray in your name. Amen.
See you. Last Sunday, Byron introduced you to our 1 Corinthians sermon series. He talked about what was going on a little bit in the church at Corinth, the church that Paul founded, considered himself father of. We might say in our lingo these days that he was the church planter at Corinth. And Paul did what he usually did when he planted churches. He spent about 18 months in Corinth, not just to teach them and to preach to them about the gospel of Jesus Christ, but to show them how to live. Sometimes when we look at Paul's writings, we get all caught up in the theology, and we forget that what was most important to Paul was that people learn not just right belief about God and about how Jesus came to show us the kingdom, but about the right way to live out our discipleship through Jesus. And so Paul did just that. He walked with those churches for a time until he was reasonably sure that they were ready to make the path on their own. Other disciples would have been in all those places. Indeed, they were in Corinth, and they continued the teaching and the preaching and the walking out discipleship with the people. Paul learned a little later, the text will tell us, from Chloe and her companions, that things had gone awry in Corinth. Corinth was maybe a lot like our culture today in these United States. Corinth was a really diverse place. There was great cultural and ethnic diversity, and because of that, there was great religious diversity. And because those Christians in Corinth were really still baby Christians, they were having trouble understanding how to prioritize their life in Christ over their life in the world. You know, most of us, when we think about 1 Corinthians, what's the first thing that comes into our minds? For me, it's love. Love. And we don't get to that piece until chapter 13. And often, when we think about 1 Corinthians 13, what's the first thing we think of? Yep, weddings. Weddings. That's because in the transmission history, the way 1 Corinthians has been used in the church, particularly in modern times, we pull out that text, we read it at weddings, and that's become our association. That love chapter is important from beginning to end of the book of 1 Corinthians. And so we need to have it on our shelf and on our minds as we begin to look at the text for today, which comes from the first chapter of Paul's first letter to Corinthians, beginning with verse 10. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? And skipping on down to verse 17, for Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel. And not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we say thanks be to God. So the divisions in Corinth were showing up as factions within the church, where groups of people were aligning themselves with either Paul as the founding father of their church, or Apollos, who was a great charismatic preacher in that time, Cephas. Some even just claimed to belong just to Christ, which was probably the closest to the right answer. Paul's concerned because this great diverse culture that the Corinthians are living in has led them into a practice of Christianity that was divided. We're not exactly sure what each of those factions believed particularly, why they clung to one or another of their teachers over the others. But what Paul knew is that that was problematic because it modeled more of the world that they lived in than the church of Jesus Christ as Paul saw it and taught about it. There would have been in Corinth in that time a temple to Isis, the Greek goddess. There were synagogues. There were Egyptian practices of worship that were prevalent in that very diverse town. Corinth was also socially stratified. We would say class by class. There were rich and wealthy people. There were people who had just recently come out of slavery, and everything in between. And so we'll learn as we move through the book that there were differences in every way that you might imagine. Class differences, differences about the ways that proper worship would be conducted, differences about whose wisdom they were to follow. And Paul says in the midst of all of this, enough. And he writes this letter, which probably in our minds culminates with that love chapter, to remind them of the wisdom of the cross of Jesus, the power of the cross, which was not powerful in the eyes of the world's wisdom, but only powerful in God's mind and heart, and in hopefully our own as we seek to follow Jesus. A power that empties itself of that worldly wisdom, of the rights to be right, of a power that manifests in what is in that 13th chapter, love. Love for God and love for neighbor as for self. And we often don't connect that great commandment that Jesus taught us, and the one that Byron's been preaching about for weeks now, with this ethic of love that Paul teaches in 1 Corinthians 13. Because what we've done with that love chapter is reduce it to the kind of love that we reserve for our marriage partners, for our families and children, for our closest of friends, the people we call our chosen families. And we forget that love that is not prideful or boastful, a love that records no wrongs, is the love that Jesus modeled for us on the cross so that we might live that love out in our encounters within the church and within the world. Those Christians at Corinth had forgotten. They had fed on the milk of Paul's teachings. They had not grown and become mature enough to understand the real meat of the gospel. And so Paul writes this letter to help correct them, to help them understand how to rightly walk out their discipleship after his own example, and indeed Apollos' example and Cephas' example, but ultimately after the example of Jesus. And so it is for us too. I don't know if you felt it when I read the beginning of this passage. I feel convicted for us. Let's look at it one more time. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and in the same purpose. That mind is the mind of Christ, and that purpose is to walk out our love. No matter what the wisdom of the world is, no matter who we follow in our lives, that's come to mean a whole different thing in these days of social media, right? Who are our greatest influences? Who are your greatest influences? Who is defining the wisdom that you cling onto for your life? As we walk through this letter of 1 Corinthians, Paul, in all manner of ways, points us back to the cross, to the wisdom of Jesus, and how to figure out how we deal with all of our divisions, which usually are based on our allegiances to the wisdom of the world in all different ways. And so our challenge as we move through these weeks will be to focus our lives on the cross, to hold to that cross-shaped wisdom, which in Paul's time was considered scandalous, that we would follow one who gave up all power, all the kinds of power that the world looks up to, in order to show us how to love. It's still scandalous, and it's still the wisdom that God calls us to. Amen. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for your great wisdom and for the wisdom of Jesus that we see through the cross. And we pray this day that we too might live cross-shaped lives, so that as we walk out our lives with you, that others might see your love made manifest in all that we say and all that we do. Bind us together, Lord, in that great love. Help us to together put down all the wisdoms of the world that threaten to divide us and unite us in your love. We thank you for Jesus, whose love empowers us to love one another. Amen.